Before I'd learned about the Horn of Africa when I was much younger, I had an Ethiopian friend who was from here in Texas, and we were having a conversation about where his parents were from, and I remember him repeatedly stating that Ethiopians and Somalians were not black. I found this incredibly strange at the time, and it took me a very long time to finally understand that what he meant was that Ethiopians and other Horn Africans are linguistically, culturally, phenotypically, and genetically distinct from other African populations. And although many argue over the self-identification and vernacular in the United States, he was right, and it blew my mind so much it was the basis for one of my first videos on race and anthropology regarding the continent of Africa, which is portrayed as a demographically homogeneous continent. However, this couldn't be further from the truth, just in the same way that the Europeans and Asians have various ethnic macro groups and racial subgroups. We discussed the continent of Africa as a whole a few weeks ago, and how it was radically changed a couple thousand years ago when a contingent of tribes gradually migrated south from their homeland in Cameroon to eventually cover the bulk of the continent south of the equator, displacing or assimilating the previous inhabitants such as the Khoi, Pygmies, or Nilotes. These tribes evolved into the Bantu peoples, Bantu being a common word for people found in many branches of the Bantu language family, and are at the very least semi-dominant in the region of sub-Saharan Africa. However, in Africa, there are many regions, and these regions contain many diverse peoples, perhaps none more intriguing than those lying on the Horn of Africa. And if the map of Africa was the head of some strange, misshapen animal, it's pretty obvious that this area would be the Horn, jutting out into the ocean, and is alternatively referred to as Northeast Africa, although this definition sometimes includes Sudan and Kenya as well, and occasionally the Horn is used to refer only to Somalia and the region of in Ethiopia, but more on that later. This region is currently divided between the countries of Djibouti, Eritrea, Ethiopia, and Somalia, although there are a rainbow of languages and cultures spread out across this landscape, with each country having a very heterogeneous ethnic makeup, other than perhaps Somalia. This is a product of not just recent European colonialism, but also thousands of years of imperialism and nation-building, although the people groups of the Horn of Africa can largely be divided into a few macro groups, the largest of which are the Habesha, also known as Abyssinians, and the Cushites, both members of the Afro-Asiatic family. I've stated in a previous video that the Cushitic languages are related to the much larger Semitic languages, somewhat assuming that Cushitic was descended from the Semitic branch. However, there's actually strong genetic, linguistic, and archaeological evidence to suggest that it's actually the other way around, with the epicenter of the Afro-Asiatic language family originating around the Horn of Africa, most likely southern Ethiopia, and spreading north to Sudan, Egypt, and the Maghreb, becoming the Egyptian and Berber languages respectively, before crossing the Sinai Peninsula and arriving in Asia around 3000 BC. The languages that entered the Arabian Peninsula through Egypt were the roots for the Semitic languages, which include Aramaic, Hebrew, Arabic, and several other dead languages such as Phoenician, although there is a lesser-known branch of the Semitic languages south of Arabia. The Habesha languages of the Horn are believed to all be descendants of the ancient Ge'ez language, which in turn most likely originated in the southern Arabian Peninsula around 3 to 4,000 years ago. So, in a way, the Habesha people and languages are a fascinating succession, going full circle from the Horn to Egypt to Arabia, then returning to the Horn again, establishing the Aksumite kingdom. Because of this, the Semitic languages of the Horn are more closely related to Arabic than their older Cushitic counterparts. However, because of proximity to each other, the two share much of the same vocabulary, and the Habesha and Cushites also share a common Horn African gene pool, although it's very difficult to accurately assess how much admixture from other racial groups is present in the Horn African population. Perhaps most interestingly, the South Semitic branch that gave birth to the Habesha nations is still present in the continent of Asia, known as the modern South Arabian languages, which despite their names are actually not a branch of Arabic, and predate Arabic in the region by centuries. These South Arabian peoples, lying mostly on the border between Yemen and Oman, are a bit of a relic of a bygone age, since they were not assimilated by the Arab expansion which covered nearly the entirety of the Arabian Peninsula. However, they're still overwhelmingly Muslim. And modern South Arabian peoples include the Mehri and Shehri in the Al-Mahra region of Yemen, as well as the Socotrans of Socotra Island off the coast of Somalia, And their appearance is quite unique, being more reminiscent of South Asians than either modern Arabs or Horn Africans. Over the many thousands of years, the Horn Africans have developed a unique gene pool and phenotype, with appearance varying greatly among individuals, being somewhat comparable to the difference between Indo-Aryans and Dravidians in the South Asian subcontinent in terms of admixture and linguistic substratum. But overall, Horn Africans have lighter skin than their Nilotic or Bantoid counterparts in their immediate vicinity, while also having significantly divergent facial features. The presence of Ethiopic paternal haplogroup E3b or EM215 in Berbers, Egyptians, Arabs, and other Afro-Asiatic populations seems to corroborate the hypothesis that the Afro-Asiatic homeland lies in the Horn of Africa, although levels of E3b greatly taper off among indigenous populations of the Arabian Peninsula. Certainly, a large proportion of the Yemeni Arab population has some admixture from the Horn of Africa as a natural result of its proximity to the region, lying only 20 miles away from Africa at its closest point, but also due to invasions by the Abyssinians, as well as the Arab slave trade, which mostly took slaves from the Swahili coast in East Africa, not the Horn, with their descendants being known as Al-Aqdam in Yemen today, although no one is quite sure how many there are in the country. Despite being outnumbered 2-to-1 in the region, the Habeshas have historically been dominant in Ethiopia and Eritrea, with the lingua franca of Ethiopia being the Amharic language, although the Amhara people are only 27% of the population, and the Amhara are overwhelmingly Orthodox Christian, famously being among the first nations in the world to adopt Christianity after the Armenians. The Tigrayans, fellow Orthodox Christians, are divided between Ethiopia and Eritrea and are very closely related to the Tigray, a smaller Islamic nation in the north of Eritrea, and these three make up the overwhelming majority of the Habesha population. The Cushitic nations include the Afar people, who are actually divided between the three countries of Eritrea, Ethiopia, and Djibouti, in an area known as the Afar Triangle or Afaria, although the separatist movement pushing for unification and independence of Afaria is rather tepid. Another major Cushitic ethnicity in Ethiopia is the Oromo people, making up 34% of their population and the largest single group. And interestingly, the Oromo are split nearly 50-50 between Christianity and Islam, making them one of the only Cushitic groups with a substantial Christian population, with Orthodoxy predominant in the northern region of Oromia, while Sunni Islam is predominant in the southern portion, which stretches almost all the way down to the coast of Kenya. Which also brings us to perhaps the most famous of all, the Somalis. Although Somalia only takes up a small chunk of the Horn in terms of land area, the greater Somali nation is truly massive, with ethnic Somalis inhabiting the eastern half of Djibouti, the Somali region of Ethiopia known as Ogaden, and the northeast corner of Kenya, with around 40% of the ethnic Somali population lying outside of Somalia, having the strongest ethno-nationalist separatist movements of any group in the Horn. Not many people know this, but Somalia was previously one of the most economically prosperous and modernized countries in all of Africa in the past, having per capita the strongest military in the entire continent for a time. However, the Ogaden War between Ethiopia and Somalia was one of the catalysts for the unfortunate collapse of the Somalian government and the failure to acquire the territories of the supposed Greater Somali State. Now, this begs the question of why Somalia and Djibouti, two Cushitic countries, are a part of the supranational organization known as the Arab League. Well, various Arab traders and merchants have been visiting the Horn for hundreds of years, and there are several small Arabic enclaves in the Horn of Africa, although as you can probably guess, almost all of them are located on the coast, with Arabic speakers on the northern coast of Somalia and Eritrea, where they are known as the Rashida Arabs, speaking a dialect remarkably similar to that in the Hejaz region in Saudi Arabia. Although genetically, those in Djibouti and Somalia are no more Arab than any other Horn African group, Arabic has essentially become a secondary language in these countries, and to a lesser extent Eritrea, which is an observer of the Arab League. It is possible that these nations could have become Arabized in a similar manner to the country of Sudan, whose genetic and phenotypic makeup bears remarkable similarity to that of the Habesha peoples of Eritrea and Ethiopia, but Arabs remain secluded to small enclaves on the coast instead, numbering in the tens of thousands at least. In the recent past, before the Arabization of the country, Sudan was inhabited by Nilotic and Cushitic groups, being an extension of the Horn African peoples. However, the Habesha are the only Cushites remaining, living on the Red Sea coast of Sudan and Egypt, being the northernmost Cushitic group, with the southernmost group being the Iraku, who arguably have one of the strangest transliterations for their name, and only recently migrated to Tanzania a few hundred years ago, numbering around 500,000 to 1 million people. Also worth noting is that Ethiopia once had one of the largest and most ancient Jewish tribes of any country, known as the Beta Israel. However, nearly the entire community of 140,000 people was evacuated to Israel in the 1980s. Thus is the bulk of the Horn African nations, who are certainly a fascinating bunch with an even more fascinating origin, being the progenitors of the Arabic, Berber, Hebrew, Hausa, and even Maltese languages, something that surprised even me. Although we couldn't discuss all of the intricacies of these nations, be sure to let me know your thoughts on the history and modern people of these countries, and to my surprisingly high number of Somalian subscribers, you guys are legends. As always, thanks for watching. This has been Mason, and I'll see you next time.